There's a huge difference between being valued and feeling valued, and one is more important than the other. I talked to about this today with Dr. Outlaw. She's an incredible administrator. She has 25 years experience, and she's going through a lot of stuff as a leader right now. And she shares a very vulnerable story about her journey as an educator, as an administrator, and how hard the last year has been. And I think it's really kind of reassuring because I know a lot of us, including myself, are struggling with many things. And to hear her to be so open and authentic about some of those struggles and talk about also some of the successes, some of the things that she's seen that's really positive. But just hearing that and being open and honest is really something I really value. But she also talks about the importance of being seen and why that matters so much. And not just talking about our students and thinking about how do we ensure that our kids are being seen, the ones that can easily fall under the radar that we don't necessarily pay attention to. We have a really great conversation about that, but also our staff and how important it is. This is such a great conversation. I felt it was just so authentic and exciting to talk to Dr. Outlaw. And she also, you know, at the end of it, shares a little bit about some tips for my daughter who wants to go to New York City one day. I just love the conversation. I hope you enjoy it. Welcome back to another episode of the Innovators Mindset Podcast. Hey everyone, welcome back to another episode of the Innovators Mindset Podcast, and I am really thrilled to have Dr. Outlaw on the podcast today. And just having a conversation with her, she's been in administration for 20 plus years, been in education, I think 25 years. Just, we were talking about this GIF, and we were actually arguing if it's GIF or JIF. I don't know if it's different in Canada versus like New York State, of this basketball player. And you'll see it on the screen if you're watching this on YouTube. There's this UCLA basketball game where one of the players puts his head down and one of his teammates comes and like lifts it up. And that is like legitimately every interaction. I feel like I'm like, I don't know. I always seem to have bad days until I connect with you. Like I'm always having a bad day. And then you're like, just like lifting my head up. And I'm sure you do it. Right. And I bet you do that. There's so many people that say that too. So I am like so excited just to talk to you, get to know you better. And hopefully all the people listening right now get to know some of your educational journey. So when you look and you go through your career, can you just tell us, you know, like how you got into education and just a little bit about your educational journey that, you know, got you 25 years in the profession?
Well, first I was going to go in business and make a whole lot of money. Where I grew up, it was certainly a struggle. I grew up in Queens and saw that my mom, and every day that she had to go to work, it was a struggle for her. And I did not want to struggle in that way. And I actually wanted to make enough money to buy her a house and take care of her and make sure that she would never have to worry about money a day in her life. And so that didn't happen because once I had to take the math classes that the business requires, right. Yeah. I was like, yeah, man, maybe that's not for me. So that math teacher that inspired me, it only went both so far. And then I then decided based on, I think in fifth grade, I had a teacher by the name of Miss Brown. Mm-hmm. And Miss Brown looked at me while I was online one day, because I guess I was the little bossy kid that would tell everybody that they needed to get in line and listen to the teacher, that I was going to be a teacher one day. It's like, this little one, she called another teacher over, this little one's going to be a teacher one day.
That's amazing.
So that planted seed started to grow slowly once the idea of making a whole lot of money was out of the way. And I said, you know what, I'll become a teacher. An English language arts teacher. And I was never a reader. Mm-hmm. I read, but I wasn't one who would devour a book. I was too worried more about what I was going to or how I was going to pass all of my classes and get the best grade that I could than sit and read. And so I said, but English language arts, you can't be wrong. That's your opinion. You just have to prove it with the text.
That's right.
I could do that. And so then I said I'd become an English language arts teacher and teach secondary because those children I could still have somewhat of an impact on. Like I wanted to make sure that I was able to help those who struggled, like myself, do well. And so after I graduated college and started teaching, I taught in New York City. I taught at Chancellor districts, and those are districts with struggling schools. And I taught at that district, and those were majority minority children. And so I said, I'm going to go in and I'm going to help them just like Mr. Campo helped me, show them that I believe in them just like Ms. Brown did, and help to uplift them.
I love that.
I absolutely love that. And so I'm hoping that a lot of people are now able to see that because of you. Because and so what I then said was that, okay, I'm gonna be there for kids. I want to make a difference for the kids that I interact with. And in two of the Chancellor districts that I was a part of, I was there for a few years, and then I came to Bayshore. And I've been here ever since. My, you know, over 20 years has been here in Bayshore, with a majority of those being a school administrator. And I moved from teaching and classroom instruction because I, in my mind, thought that I would help to make a difference for more children by helping to be impactful with staff. And so when I came to Bayshore, I felt like I had died and gone to heaven because resources in the Chancellor's districts, it was, I remember having to like make or give a code, and I was limited to the number of copies that I could make. And so when I came to Bayshore, like I brought, okay, so you would get a stipend as a New York City teacher. And at that time, it was $250 in the year because they knew that you were buying your own supplies. I saved up my little check so that I could buy a personal copier just so that I could make copies.
Are you kidding? That's amazing. Kids
that I was teaching. And so then, like, I bought my little personal copier, and I didn't have to worry about the, you know, kind of minimization that was being imposed upon me for copies. And when I came to Bayshore, I'll never forget, I needed to make some copies. And I said, okay, so what code do I have to put in? Where do I have to go? And they're like, what are you talking about? And I said, no, in the city, I had to put in a code, and I only had like let's say 100 copies that I could do for the year or whatever. And they're like, no, you just go into the copy room and make copies. I was like, really? I felt like I died and went to heaven. I was like, you can make as many copies.
This is like, this is like hashtag teacher things.
Yes. And it was Christmas. Like, it was just Christmas. And so I then, when thinking about going to administration, I knew that Bayshore was the only place that I wanted to be an administrator in, because of the way that you felt in the buildings. Everyone was pleasant. Everyone wanted to help you. And I wanted to keep that going as the school leader, where the culture that I cultivated was one where when someone walked through that front door, that they felt like they were already home, that they were already welcome, and that they were already a part of something, and that they mattered. Because all throughout my years, both, you know, growing up as a kid and then teaching, I was in the shadows. Whether I put myself there or whether I was made to sort of know my place. And I say that because I just finished reading the book Cast, which was amazing. And they talk about sort of the situations that make people feel like they need to be silent more than they need to speak. And more about recognizing that when people feel heard, they actually contribute more to the culture and environment, because they then are empowered to do things, share things that at times they might have been silent about. And it's those different voices that I try to encourage, and that I seek to make sure that I include, I try to amplify the voices of the quietest person mm-hmm. in the room, because I recognize that once I do that, and once I support them, and once I encourage that, that they excel far beyond what they themselves even thought mm-hmm. was possible.
Well, so it's interesting, like, you know, we like you kind of joke a little bit about the photocopier thing, but there's something really big about that, right? And when you say about how it's like, I want to be at a place where I feel appreciated, where it's not just you say it, the actions line up. And it's like saying, oh, like, we so appreciate teachers, like, they're the best. And but we need you to kind of spend all your own money, and we need you to do this, and we're not going to really, like, do these things. And so, like, but we so appreciate you. And it's like, well, not really, like, none of your actions are lining up with that. And I always talk about the difference that there is a really important, and it's like you exemplified the story, is that there is a difference between being valued and feeling valued. And when you did the photocopier thing, that was you feeling valued, and like, that's what I want to be. And I think when we get that feeling, we want to create that for others too, where they have this is going to be, this is just our school district, but this was such a subtle thing. It was just a little thing, and this might, like, throw off some people listening to this. So when I was a principal, every staff member had their own school credit card, right? Like, they had a legitimate, their own credit card, and I'm not even kidding. They had a certain limit of, like, what they would do, so that they wouldn't, like, there was not even the step of, like, you go buy stuff and then we'll reimburse you. It's like, no, you use a credit card. And, like, if we see you're buying a sports car, like, we're going to flag that, and there's going to be something there. And, like, you had to, like, you know, say, like, yeah, I bought this, blah, blah, blah. But it wasn't like, we didn't even want that temporary. And, like, just even thinking about it, there was times in my career where, like, I had $1,000 overdraft, and I was, like, always within $20 of it at the end of each month. So I couldn't spend an extra $25, right, on school supplies. Yeah. And, like, you know, I remember that was something I really struggled with. And so that was never something that a teacher had to deal with. And we'd say, like, hey, you got, like, an X amount of limit for the year. But if you need to go beyond it, just come and talk to me, and we'll, like, wow. You know. And so, like, little things like that make a difference. And I think a lot of people, when they actually see that, like, when they actually, that little thing is something about making sure people feel appreciated, that they're not mm-hmm. doing this. And I've always had this issue. And it's, like, just kind of understood that teachers spend their own money. And I'm like, what? What are you talking about? Like, if it's for kids, then we as a school should be paying for that. It should never be coming out of teachers' pockets. And as an administrator, like, we figure out those solutions. Like, we figure out that process. But, you know, I don't know every school situation, but I honestly believe then we got to do everything to feel away. Don't just assume teachers can pay out of that pocket. Yes. I got to ask you this question. And did you struggle a bit as a student? Like, kind of like you seem like some stuff you struggle with, or like, did you ever, you mentioned something about, like, kind of just kind of gaming the system a little bit with, like, English language arts.
Well, yes, I did. I struggled, and worked really hard at trying not to.
Yeah.
And it frustrated me because, I almost felt like I was supposed to know these things. Mm-hmm. I was supposed to get it as easy as other children did. I had a friend. I would connect myself to the smartest person in the room. Mm-hmm. Right? And so whoever the smartest kid was, I wanted to sit next to that kid because I wanted to see how they did what they did.
Right.
And I then was never seen by the teacher in the same way mm-hmm. as the person who I was trying to at least mm-hmm. Emulate in some way, shape, or form. And so by the time that I got to high school, I gave up. Mm-hmm. I figured, you know what, I keep trying and I'm not getting there. I'm not being seen and I'm getting good grades. And I'm sure my mom, you know, loved me, mm-hmm. but there was never any emphasis on, right. you know, getting good grades, not. And in high school, I started hanging with a different crowd and didn't do all the things mm-hmm. that I was supposed to. And then had to play catch up when I failed a couple of classes and wanted to graduate a little earlier. Just started to see that if I didn't work hard, mm-hmm. that I wasn't going to get where I wanted to go. Friends started making fun of me by having my backpack on all the time and mm-hmm. having my books and that sort of thing, but I knew where I wanted to go mm-hmm. and that if I didn't work hard, I wouldn't get there. And so I had to sort of try to make up for lost time. And I started to not believe in my own abilities even more so, mm-hmm. Almost as if I was living up to the expectations that some had of me not going anywhere or doing very much. And so when I think about sort of the role that teachers play in where a child either is seen or views him or herself, that small words can help to make such a significant difference. And I know everybody knows this, but a smile in and of mm-hmm. itself and can just turn a kid's world around. And so I wanted to give more of that to the children that I served mm-hmm. because even through the struggles, no child, and you mentioned this when we were talking a little bit before, mm-hmm. no one wants to do bad.
Right.
We don't get up nope. every morning saying, I'm going to figure out how I can upset a teacher, or I'm just, you know, I'm not going to do any work today.
Mm-hmm.
There's a self fulfilling prophecy that that child could be enacting, but simply because they've hit a brick wall every time that they've tried. Mm-hmm. And so it becomes, why try if I'm still going to hit the same wall? And so I think just turning things around a little bit mm-hmm. for one kid can make a significant difference for more of them.
Well, what's interesting, the reason you kind of alluded that you struggled a little bit, and that's kind of where I picked it up on, but it's interesting because you can see that that impact, like on you as a child, has helped you become a successful administrator, right? Because you don't want kids to feel that. And like, I was a bad kid. And like kindergarten, grade eight, I was like an angel. And then I don't know what happened, you know, I guess puberty, I don't know. I was just terrible. And for several years. And when kids got sent to my office, I'm like, that's it. That's all you did. Like, I've done way worse, right? Like, this is nothing. And just kind of like hearing some of that, but you became like an advocate. And you said something that I think is really important and really resonates with me. And I sometimes want to point out the bad example just so people, like, if they do that, I'm like, don't do that, right? Like the smile. I really struggled when I saw adults pass children in a school and not acknowledge them. I don't care if you teach them or not. I honestly don't. Yeah. And there was a student in I listened to that had struggled. She had talked about literally being suicidal for years. And she said this, and I'll never forget it. This is in West Allis. Deidre Raymer, who's been on the podcast, hosted this. She brought students to talk that students who struggled in school and said, like, hey, here's my experience. And like, let's try not to have this. She said that there is a teacher in that school who greeted her and said her name every single day, never taught her once. And that was what kept her alive for 4 years. And it's just like that was just like, never taught her one class ever. And then the thing that I want to point out, the negative, I remember this one principal that, and I'm not going to get into too many details, that when they walked down the hallway, it was like the parting of the Red Sea. Everyone was terrified. And it was almost like they wanted that. That's what they wanted. It was like I'm the principal, right? And I know they did very well in school. And it was like the expectation, and it's like, a lot of kids don't see themselves. And like you said, you know, I want to be really good. The part of the reason I was such a bad kid is because I struggled academically, but I was going to be the best at something. And if it was the best annoying kid, then I'll be that. Cause I could rule that. No one's going to challenge me on that.
That comes easy.
Yeah. Like, and so like, I was like, hey, I don't want to be seen as the dumb kid. I'm going to be like the most annoying kid. Like I'm going to get the award for being the most annoying. So I'm the best at something in this class. Right. And so I appreciate that. But do you find that experience, like how does that help you as an administrator with kids right now?
And this is something that I encourage with the staff as well. It's that idea of being seen mm-hmm. again. My mornings I spend, you know, good morning, how are you? Right. Come on in, and saying the names and everything. Hey, sweetheart, how are you? Mm-hmm. But just acknowledging the children and the adults. Mm-hmm. So we stop. I stand out in my vestibule with a book in my hand, right? Because mm-hmm. I'm a big proponent of reading right now.
Yeah. It's in your email. Every time it's in your email what you read.
Yes. And I'll hold a book because it's one of the most non-threatening ways to invite conversation. Mm-hmm. I will hold whatever book I'm reading in my hand. And sometimes it's a middle grade book mm-hmm. so that the kids are like, oh, Dr. Outlaw, what are you reading right now? Or sometimes it's whatever text I'm reading and the teachers are like, oh, what are you reading right now? So that conversations are had beyond, for kids especially, a disciplinary one with the principal. Mm-hmm. Because often what happens is I'm sitting with a kid when it's gotten too far. Mm-hmm. And so my interactions with children who either can go unseen or the children who is doing well, I have the opportunity in the cafeterias with that book and in the hallways with that book to have conversations with them so that they are seen. Mm-hmm. And those good mornings matter, those smiles matter, and how are you doing
totally
matters.
And this is something that I always point out when like I talk about this, and I think it's really important. I guarantee you that time you spend saves you hours later, right? It saves you hours for parents who might not trust you because you never have contacted them. That staff that, you know, you don't really talk to them, you know, that kid that this is their first interaction that they have with you because, you know, like, but if you interact with them hallway, you have some pleasantry, and it's kind of like, you know, it's the cliche, like you want a kid when they do something wrong, you want them to feel that you're disappointed in them, because that's the killer. Because the only reason you feel that, any kid feels that, is that you built a relationship. Like that's the only way that actually happens. And I think that to me is like so important to the work that we actually do, and having those conversations and having some of those things. And I appreciate that. And I love that strategy of just holding a book, right? Like, and what they might ask you, conversation, you know, I was same as you. I felt like when you said like, yeah, I wasn't a big reader. Like I did the same thing. I'd read a bit and write an essay and just say like, can't be right. Wrong. It's my opinion. Right.
That's so right. I love that. And I, along the lines with holding the book, and this probably is hard for some to believe. I don't really like a whole lot of social, interactions, conversations, whatever you want to call it. At times I see myself as an introvert, and carrying a book allows me to have others come into a conversation with me and engage me in a conversation around something that I enjoy, right? And they evidently must as well. And so then it allows for an organic development mm-hmm. of a relationship that may not have existed before or have ever been sought out by either the student or me or the staff member and me. So it was one of the, I call it low-hanging fruit strategies mm-hmm. or one of those ways in which it's, no matter your personality, mm-hmm. whether you're one who always wants to reach out or not, you can do it. It's, everybody can do that.
I love that. So it's like carrying a prop. I love it. Hey, so, okay, I thought of something, and I want your thoughts on this, and I'll never forget this. And, you know, we've talked enough. I know, you know, I love basketball. I'm really into sports and things like this. And there's this analogy I give. So I remember there's these two coaches, right? And this is, like, legit. And there was this one coach who would mouth off the entire game. And you just ignored him. You just ignored him because it's like, and I learned a lot about that, is that sometimes when you speak too much, that people just tune you out, right? And then there was this other coach who never said anything and then might snap on you. And he would be like 1/10 of annoying as the other person, but it was so rare that you would like give him a technical, right? And I remember reffing this, and it's like, I remember this one time when I was teaching, and you have some kids who are struggling, you know, goofing off all the time. And then I have this one student who's like top academic student in the class. And she was an incredible athlete. And I remember her goofing off in class just a bit. And I just was God on her about it and just like gave her a hard time. She's like, Mr. Couros, like I don't ever do anything wrong.
Yeah.
You ignore that kid who's doing 10 times worse because you're so used to it. And then you get on me for doing one thing, right? And you do this. And I don't think that's fair. And I was like, that's a really good point, right? Like I'm holding you to, like, basically you have to be perfect. And as long as this kid's not like eating their pencil, then I'm good. Right. And
jumping out of the window.
Yeah. And I've always, like, she actually, like, her mom reached out to me, just recently. It was my birthday recently. And she said, like, you are my daughter's favorite teacher. And because I actually like, I didn't say, nope, too bad. I was like, that's actually a really good point. Like, thank you. And I would like, she was like, and it's like, she taught me, right? Like that cliche, but she like legit at me. And I'm like, oh, that's actually like, I'm being wrong here. Like, and I think sometimes, I think part of that notion of what you say about being seen, right, is that we assume some kids are seen because they might be doing academically well. And then something crazy happens. Like, I can't believe it, that kid. And it's like, well, no one was paying attention to them. Right. Because they kind of flew under the radar because they were always good. I wonder what you think about that advice from that student. Like I was like, yeah, that was a good lesson for me.
But we do it all the time.
Yeah.
Even with staff, we do that all the time. If the staff member says, no, I'm okay, I'm good.
Yeah.
We move on to that. You mentioned in our earlier conversation that 90% of our time is spent with 10% of our population, right? And so when those that are doing what they usually do kind of keep doing what they usually do, they go unseen. Mm-hmm. And those that then are the squeaky wheels that are constantly telling us how much work they have and the things that are going on and how they're struggling, we're always trying to make sure they're okay.
Yeah.
So there was an idea by Allison, I want to say, and I know that she's one that you mentioned while we were in the LLA course.
Yeah.
And there was that one question survey that she had created, sent out to her staff. I was like, oh, another low-hanging idea that I could implement, right? There's no risk, low risk. That was the word that I was trying to think of.
Allison, I think it was Allison Apsey, the principal in Michigan, right?
Yes, yes. I'm so sorry. I'm mixing up names.
Yeah, yeah, no.
that low risk action step allowed me to ask the staff, how are you doing? And identify those who were like sharing, I'm okay. Mm-hmm. Because what I did was, after a couple of weeks of them saying they're okay, I wrote a handwritten card that said, thanks for always taking the time out of your busy schedule to make sure that you are letting me know how you're doing. Just know that I'm here if there's ever anything that you need. And I got a lot of notes back that said, like, thanks for, you know, kind of touching base. But it was really all so that they knew, even though they were okay, that they were still seen, that they still mattered in the grand scheme of it all. Because there's nothing worse than, you know, you trying to hang in there and do what you need to and feeling like it's not being recognized.
Well, there is this thing, right? Like when we have high, and I'm speaking specifically about staff members, is that we have high achieving staff who you just assume to do great stuff. And they, and then we pay attention to, you know, parts of struggle, and this is all aspects of life. And sometimes those really high achieving people leave. They're gone because they craved mentorship, but they didn't necessarily need it. Or we said, hey, we know that you always come through on stuff. So, and I think Todd Whitaker talks about this, basically as a punishment for you coming through with stuff, we're going to just pile things on to you and, you know, just compound that and see how much we can work you, because we know that person's going to say no. Right. So we're not even going to bother, not even going to have the conversation. So like, we're going to punish you for doing such a great job. And I think we just have to be, I think we have to be aware of that, because sometimes people that really do a great job, when they're not getting any attention, they still want to grow. They still want mentorship. They want places where they feel they develop. And I feel like you basically want, like a lot of people that I know and I've connected with, they outgrow their school districts because nobody's trying to help them to get better. It's like, they're applauded for being awesome, but no one's like pushing them still. And they're like, look, that's what I want to do. Like, I want to get better at what I do. And if no one's pushing me, I'm going to go somewhere where they will. Right. I'm going to ask you, and we've had a couple conversations about this. So tell me about this school year. Tell me, because I think a lot of people, and I know, like, you know, like, just tell me about the school year, because I think, you know, this is one of the reasons why I have you on the podcast. You're a principal doing this work, and I can't even imagine how hard it is. Like, I can't even imagine how hard it is in any role education.
I'll try and sum it up by saying there are several times where I said, if I could take my keys and I could put them on the desk,
right,
and I could say good luck to whoever was going to sit here, I would have done that in a heartbeat.
Right.
And it's really because everything that I knew about leadership and about being a good school leader was out the window.
Right.
Like, I felt like it was, I felt like I became a manager all over again. My first year was tough, but this year was even more difficult than my first. And what I felt like, things were constantly changing, and trying to manage that change, trying to keep the staff sort of informed and understanding about those changes, and trying to help them through the struggles that they were having while trying to manage my own, it just left me feeling depleted. And as a result, I didn't know how to gather enough to sustain them and me. And I just felt like a failure. I really did. I felt like I'm not doing enough to keep this going. And so I just wanted out. I wanted to run. I said, there were times where I said, if I could crawl up in a corner, stick my thumb in my mouth and rock, I would have done that. I seriously considered it.
And that's, I think a lot of people, like, and I'll ask you what, because you're still here. You didn't give up the keys. So I don't know. I don't know if you're like, if we're in the 2 week notice part or something like that.
Another reveal.
Right. Moving on to the superintendency. But I really wonder how many people took early retirement this year, said, you know what? I'm out. Like, I'm good. I don't want to be here this year. And like, understandably so. And I think one of the things I appreciate is that I think, like, I do this quite a bit, and it's really interesting, because I'll say, like, hey, here's this thing that I did that really worked, and here's this thing that's awesome. And I'll get like, hey, thanks for the idea. And then I'll say like, hey, I sucked at this. I had a really hard time. And I just get like tons of emails like, thank you for saying it. I feel I'm not alone. You know, cause like, I think a lot of people need to hear this. Right. And I know that you are a very still positive person.
Right? I have a Voxer group. That's a middle school principals Voxer group. And if not for those external supports, I don't know that I would have been able to keep this going. What I found was that I could talk with them candidly. And they were struggling and going through the same things. Like, how are you going to open up the building? I'm like, I don't know. What is the school year going to look like? I don't know. But yet I had to make the decisions that were needed before I knew what I needed to do. And so when they were going through the same things, shout out to my middle school principal Voxer group.
Okay, just a, you got the shout out to the middle school principal Voxer group. I love how you queued that up. I was like, I wasn't ready. I was like, oh, I had to get the button ready.
I leaned on them heavily. I did. And then because of the things that they were doing, they inspired me to try some of those things. So, for example, like we had a principal in the group who put together little cards to put in the mailboxes of the teachers just to say, you know, a lifesaver thing and hang in there. So they, I was like, let me do that. I got so much feedback about that. I'm like, yes, that fed me. The positive energy then said, wait, it's not so far different when you're able to help them see the potential in themselves and you get that energy back. It sustains you for a little bit longer. And then you look for something else that will sustain you for a little bit longer. And so those little moments that can carry you through is what helped me to not put those keys on the desk.
You're not going anywhere. So, so the, like when I'm listening to you, it's kind of like, and it's actually interesting because when I first became a principal, I actually, that's when I really started on Twitter because you're the only one. That's it, right? You're the only principal. And as much as you rely on your assistant principal, your admin team, things like that, it's the one that's, you're the only one there, right? Like you're the only one in that position. And it's kind of like when you find those groups, it's like you're alone together. Do you know what I mean? Like that, that's a way is like, hey, and it's not like you're trying to separate yourself from teaching, but your role is unique and it's hard. Sometimes you have to go to the people who have done that job and maybe who are new to the job or, you know, have fresh ideas and things like that, because you're going in that spaces. So you go, you're going into the spaces. So that's good. And it's like, you know, it's, I'm sure too, great ideas, things that you could do with your staff, but just like you said, to be seen and to be heard and like saying like, this sucks. This is like so hard. And someone saying, yeah, it does suck. And that's it. Like not saying it sucks, but it's like, nope, it sucks. Like, and you know, I think a lot of, it's good.
And
it's
I
good
didn't
to have
feel
that.
Judged. I'll tell you. The main thing was that I didn't feel like I was being judged, where I felt like every step of the way with every other decision and action that I was being judged because I was the building principal and I was the one responsible for the culture and for leading things. And, you know, if I made a mistake and I could talk about it with the group, it didn't inhibit me from being able to acknowledge that.
So I talked about basketball before and this analogy, and I know you'll appreciate this. So I reffed for years and this is what the thing with, and it's the same thing with administrators. If you are a really good ref, nobody notices you. Nobody notices you. If you suck, everyone notices you, right? Everyone. And it's like, and it's like, you like, because the part of it, like if you're a referee, people don't even notice you're in the game because it's just, you know, it's called so smoothly. But yeah. It, and I think that that's how you kind of feel sometimes as administrators, that if things go wrong, it's like the spotlight now is on you and you're feeling, and it's, a, and the other analogy too, I think is you are like also you feel wrong to 50% of the people 100% of the time, but the 50%, the 100% doesn't go away, but the 50% changes back and forth, right? You made this decision. Yeah. These people are mad. These people are mad about this decision, right? And it kind of goes back and forth. So taking this year, what would you say, and you can say if there's none, like what would you say has been like something that you've seen as a success? Like this thing went well, or I'm really proud of this. Like, is there something, and I know that we've talked enough that I'm sure you got at least, yeah. And maybe it's that, maybe it's that your keys are not turned in. Maybe that's what yeah. it is. But like, what would you point to is like, this is the one thing I'm really proud of this year.
Yeah, the in the communications, the acknowledgement of how hard things have been for the staff, mm-hmm. and the struggles that they're going through, the changes, and letting them, I think what's been a success is acknowledging the difficulty, mm-hmm. and recognizing that this is unlike any other right. year that we've ever had, but we're going through this together. We're learning about this together, and we're going to come out better for it mm-hmm. on the other end of this. And the way we're going to do that is by sticking together mm-hmm. and riding the wave. And when we hit the shoreline, we'll be able to stand on our two feet because we held each other's arms. Mm-hmm. And I think that the success in that is what's going to help sustain us. Like Covey says about mm-hmm. building that emotional bank account, you know, it's the tough times is where I think you have the ability to build mm-hmm. relationships more just simply by acknowledging and helping to support, give whatever it is that's needed at the time that you can, because you know that everything else is tough.
Well, we talked before about making sure that this is not just, we don't see this as a blip to go back to what we were doing, right?
Yes.
Like, it's like, oh, this is like super
Please
inconvenient.
Don't.
Yeah, yes. This is super inconvenient. And I think you tied it in, and this is the conversation we had before we recorded. That idea of like people talking, like learning loss is such a, I'm just so, there's like certain things that, like learning loss, I'm sick of, unprecedented, I can't hear again. Yes. Like, I'm just like, okay, whatever, right? You know, I just like, I'm just quarantined is another one I'm sick of, but that's a whole other conversation.
Tracing.
Yeah, especially in Canada. So I think part of it too is that really, like, a lot has been gained in what we've learned, right? Like a lot of how we deal with adversity, you know, I think there's this one time I was working with these high school kids, and they were like, and this was just recently, and they told me that when it was announced that basically they were going to have a 2-week break, right? 2 weeks to slow the spread. That's what we're a year and a half in or whatever. Right. And they were so excited. They were like, oh, this is going to be this COVID thing is like awesome. Right. Cause we got like 2 weeks off school. This is going to be great. And they said they were about 2 or 3 days in, and they're like, this sucks. And I think it's even just an appreciation for what school is for many kids, right? And for many adults too, is that space too, where they feel. So I think we have to, like, with all the talk of learning loss, I think we have to talk about what's been gained and what do we appreciate more, what have we learned, and what makes us better. So I think that's a really important aspect. I'm going to ask you,
one of the most important aspects of what we've gone through is, let's not forget that we have always had children who come to us at different places mm. in their academic career. And so to blame it on the pandemic or the closures mm-hmm. of school, I think certainly there's something to it. I'm not going to say that right. there isn't truth to that. But understand that our children have always come to us in different places, and meeting them where they were is what was most important in helping to move them forward. Mm-hmm. So if we look at them as if they are still at even more of a deficit than they right. were, that we're doing them a disservice rather than saying, okay, tell me where you are
right.
and let's get you where you need to be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think it's just that belief, right? I think it's like what you said earlier, is just kind of being seen where you're at, and having that. And I think if you have caring adults, it'll be fine. I'm not worried about it. Like, I feel comfortable, and I know people are going to, you know, do what they need to do to help kids.
I have a question for you, and I don't know if you want to answer it now or not. Sure. You had talked about sort of entertaining the idea of being...
The podcast mic has changed.
Turn around.
All right. I'm like, oh, jeez.
Yeah. and so if you were...
Right.
Back in the building.
Right.
Leading your own team again. What would you, as the building principal, do?
Well, this is a conversation that's all over the place, is about like self-care, mental health, emotional well-being, social emotional learning, things like that. And I think it's really, I think that's the most important aspect of this, right? I know that there's times in my career where I basically was like, honestly, nervous breakdown, couldn't do it. And I was so blessed to have administrators that said, you need to take some time off. Like, you need to like go, right? Like, you need to, and it's not like a negative thing. It's not like a weakness. It's just like, we need you to be okay. Like, we really appreciate you, right? And I think that's important. And I think when you're looking at these schools, and this is something I've been really, really challenging too, because I have had lots of mental health struggles. It's not like they are gone, right? It's not like I just, you know, they are fixed and all that other stuff. But I think that the thing that really needs to be addressed is what is causing those issues, not giving remedies to issues we are causing, right? And I always make this kind of light joke, is like, we're going to work you to death. We're just going to like pile everything onto you, but then we're going to have yoga at lunch because that will make everything better. It's like, no, like, I don't want to do yoga. Just don't do all those other things that make it impossible, right? And as when I give this, in the experience I have at Central Office, this is one of the things. I know this is not totally answering your question, but kind of is. I'm sure you'll appreciate this. When I worked at Central Office, and I would have arguments with my colleagues about this, I would say our job is not to pile on things to our staff. Our job is to take things off of their plate. So when all departments are sending surveys to everybody at the exact same time to validate our job, that's not helping anybody, right? Like, it's like, why are you doing that? Because I need this data to like prove that you should hire me, blah, blah, blah. And I didn't feel like I needed that. I said, like, you know, I got tons of evidence of what schools are doing, things like that. So I think just kind of going at the whole district level, and not just thinking about this in terms of a principal, because I'm sure you get I'm sure you don't get this, right? I don't want to get anyone in trouble. So I'm sure you get things. You're like, seriously, like, why are you putting this on our staff right now? Like, are you kidding me? And then like, part of my job as administrator was to filter as much away from my staff that I felt was not necessary, but still get it done. But then what happens is that it's bad for you as a principal, right? And I wrote about this in Innovates of the Box in the last chapter. Like, I was always shielding everybody from everything else, and then eventually caught up to me, right? And I think it's just we have to start giving some of those really, and it's not about like, I think when people talk about this, they kind of think like, oh, like, you're just soft. Like, this generation's soft. I'm like, no, this is like, you're asking ridiculous things. And like, so we, you know, based on your experience, we were around the same age. So we went to school in the 80s, right? Like, you went to school in the 80s for some point, right? The thing is that, think about, so we learned cursive, we learned this, blah, 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 whatever, right? So go back 10 years, you had to learn things, but there are certain things you didn't have to learn. Advanced 10 years, you're expected to learn all the same things that I learned in the 80s, plus this, 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 and this.
Yes.
Then go another 10 years. So it's like, the thing is that the time frame of the day is literally exactly the same when I went to school. The expectations just grow and grow and grow. And it's like, whoa, 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 whoa. We got to back off on some stuff. Like, we got to, do we really need to be doing this? Like, do we need to be piling this stuff on? And I think that's the conversation that schools have to have more, is like, hey, do we really need, like, I know you are really connected to cursive handwriting. And I know that you, that, but is this really like this kid can curse it, but they don't know how to, like, but we have adults who don't know how to go on a Zoom. They don't know how to click a link, right? What are the basics? So I think it's just like conversations of like we, and this is really interesting. If I ever ask teachers this, this is the hardest question for them to answer. What should you take off the plate? I've asked that, like, what can we take off the plate? And they have a really hard time because it's just so embedded that everything's important, right? And I think to me, it's like, just like, let's just take a step back, look at what's needed. What can we just say, no, we don't need to do this anymore. What can we take off of plates, right? So I don't know if that's like a cop-out answer, but I think that, and you said this, but you shared many examples of this, that you just get, people get so overwhelmed. Like, it's like, oh, my plate is full. No, it's not, my plate is not full. I have a platter and it's overflowing.
Yes.
Like, you're just, it's nonstop. But thanks for the yoga class, right? It's like, no, that's not enough. So, so it's like that, I think that, like, the whole purpose of that is not to go soft on people, but it is to get people, it is to help them do a better job. That is the focus. It's like, if you take care of people, then they take care of the kids, then everyone does better. But if people can't, like, get up in the morning because they're so overwhelmed, what's that helping? So,
and we often don't take the time to, I think, have the conversations that help people see what is the important stuff.
Right.
So that they recognize what they can either take off the plate or put to the side.
Totally.
And there's so many distractions right now. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I say this to when I do workshops, and I say, look, I do not want to add time to your day. I want you to look at things, how you could do them different and better. And so I'll say, like, hey, I know many of you are doing this. Have you thought about doing this instead? This might promote deeper learning. And if you don't think it does, then don't do it. But don't do what you're doing plus. We got to, like, say what goes, right?
And that's what leaders need, I think, whether it's training or support in doing, is helping others to recognize, or at least what questions should I be asking to help teachers figure out where's the importance.
Totally.
Where's the important stuff.
So Dr. Outlaw, I know that you are very busy and we're like coming up to the end of your time. So I'm going to take this advantage.
I don't want to go.
No, I love this. This is great. But I'm going to ask you a personal question that has nothing to do with, K-12 education, so you're in Long Island, and I grew up an Islanders fan, and so I just figured, like, basically everyone in Long Island lived 20 minutes from each other, but it's not like that. It's like huge, right? So you said you grew up in Queens, correct?
Yes.
Okay, so my daughter.
Good memory there.
Yeah. So I actually listen. It's like one of the best things about the podcast is actually I've learned to listen to people. I'm taking advantage of this, that you grew up in New York. So this is like this part of the podcast is directly for my daughter, Kallea. So she is 4.5. If you ask her, like, I'll say, when this is all over, where do you want to go? New York City. So if you're talking to my daughter right now, when this is all over, what do we need to do? And you can't say Statue of Liberty. You can't say like the touristy things. No. You got to give us like you grew up there, the versions.
Yes. Okay. Right? And I love the name Kallea. Like, that's just melodic.
She's a good kid.
First I'm going to tell you, come to Long Island for the beaches.
Okay. Right?
At least. And you don't have to go to the Hamptons. The beaches are just as beautiful, Rockaway Beach or otherwise. But you definitely want to, when you come or to New York City, you're going to have to make sure that you get to, I don't want to say Central Park, right? Mm-hmm.
but
you can say Central Park. You can say Central
Park. No, but that's too, no, that's like too common.
Right.
Like you're going to get there no matter what. You come to the city, you make sure that you get there. But you want to make sure that you get to, I think the Brooklyn, like where the Brooklyn Nets play.
Oh, yeah.
You gotta get, now you love basketball.
I do love basketball.
She's gonna love it too.
Brooklyn has a good team now too.
She's gonna love it too.
Yeah.
Yes. And so I think that you want to make sure that you take her there and then to Coney Island so that she has a bit of the amusement park.
I forgot about Coney Island. That was like a thing as a kid and you don't hear about it as much anymore. I don't know. I just, right? Yeah.
They had to close. For a while with
like everything
the
else
pandemic.
Like everything, yes. Right, yeah, no, she, that's her, so it, she, her dream, like her 4.5-year-old dream is New York Taylor Swift concert, like that's like she wants, right, and like that's that's everything for her. So like I've got her really into like vinyl. She loves vinyl records because she just feels she has more control. Like it's really kind of interesting to see that. Like she, we have access to like music on our phones, blah, blah, blah. And she wants that. She likes that vinyl experience. God. And I think that's, you know, that's me kind of, you know, brainwashing her
to
it.
That's all you.
That's
all you. Right?
So, hey, I'm going to clip that out just for Kallea. So, you know, cause she's really excited about that. But Dr. Outlaw, seriously, it was awesome just to hang out with you. And I told you, this is like totally selfish. I love doing the podcast and just, you know, getting to know you better, kind of hear about your journey. So hopefully
I'm the blessed one. I'm lucky.
Right. I did the same thing for you as, you know, did that little lift your head up thing. So everyone, can I ask you, like you said, you're on Twitter, right? So
yes.
How do we find you on Twitter?
At DRL Outlaw.
DRL Outlaw. So that is actually in the description for anyone. Make sure you connect with Dr. Outlaw. She is awesome. Yes. And like, is it, you know, you said you had a really tough year and it's just amazing how you, I just see how you lift everybody up, including myself. So it is
you're
awesome.
Carrying me down to June. So thank you.
That's it. Okay. And we're recording this in April. So, all right. So if we need to do like an emergency podcast, you know, mid June, let me know. Okay.
I will.
Okay. All right. Thanks, everybody, for listening. Dr. Outlaw, thanks for being my guest today, and I hope you all have a wonderful day. Take care.